Hi. So today we're going to talk about reflective teaching, which really relates to self-regulated learning, because we're going to be talking about how you as a teacher can use some of these metacognitive practices to improve your own teaching through reflective practices. So let's talk about reflective teaching. The first one is teachers matter. We know that you can think back to teachers who've made a difference in your life, teachers that have taught you things that have made an impact, and teachers matter for student learning. They also matter for student success. We know that the things that you do in a classroom impact the way that students learn. So that the way that you teach, the things you do in the classroom matters. So how you learn about that matters. How what teachers do and how they learn about their own practice matters. And that we learn from our teaching, so that we must continue our professional development, not just through school and through your education program, but beyond that, and learn from what we do every day, and continuous growth. So how can we improve our reflection skills to improve our teaching? So some characteristics of effective reflection. I know that throughout your careers here at UNF, you're going to be asked to reflect on your readings, on your experiences in classrooms, and on your own teaching. So what are some ways that you can do that effectively? It's active. It's something that you are taking a part of. You're not passive in it, but you are cognitively engaged. You're focusing on the intent and the effect of your actions. What were you intending to do, and what was the desired effect? Did you achieve your desired effect? Or were there unintentional consequences from what you intended to do? And that you're observing and analyzing. So you're not just writing down what happened or what you remember happened, but you're also analyzing, you're taking a critical eye to that and picking it apart and doing some critical thinking around it. And that really, this reflective process is a formative assessment of your teaching. You're using this data to inform your future practice. So what are some ways we can collect data on our reflective teaching, a reflective practice? The first one's through student feedback. The first and most common way to get student feedback is just through their behavior. What kinds of behavior would give you insight into your effectiveness? What kinds of things might you observe in a classroom that would tell you if you're being effective or ineffective as a teacher? And then there's formal feedback. You could do focus groups with small groups of students or a whole class discussion about your teaching practices and what they like or don't like about what's happening in the classroom or how they feel about the classroom instruction or what their preferences are. You could do that similarly through open-ended surveys, asking them questions and having them respond. You could also do Likert type scales. So asking students to respond with agree to disagree statements on a scale, or you can use published instruments. And my question to you is, we do get a lot of student feedback at the university level through ISQs. And as a professor, I'm responsible for thinking about how I use that ISQ data to improve my own thinking. Certainly, in the surveys that I gave you at midterm in this class, I asked you for feedback and I've tried to modify my expectations for the class based upon the types of feedback that I got. To try to, if there were things that were unclear, if there were assignments that didn't make sense, I try to change what I do based upon the feedback that I've been given. I added more examples of papers in this class to try to meet the needs of the confusion that some students were feeling about the way the class was moving in some instances. And similarly with the feedback at the end of the year and the ISQ data, I can modify what I do in class based upon that data. That data is also used for our evaluations by our chairs and our deans. And it can determine if we get bonus merit pay for our effectiveness. It can determine whether or not we even get to keep our jobs. So don't think that those ISQs go into some vault that no one ever looks at. It's absolutely vital to our jobs here at UNF. So it's really important that you're honest and that you provide high quality feedback when you get those surveys. We really do depend on you to for your feedback, and it's important that you give that to us. So I look forward to reading it every semester to find out what you guys value about my teaching and what perhaps I could improve upon. I also appreciate those improvement pieces to be sent to me through email. After the semester is over, if there's some things you think I could follow up on, if you want to send that privately as well, I would also, appreciate that kind of feedback too. So student feedback is important for all of our reflective practice. We can also have peer assessments and self-assessments. One thing is a classroom observation schedule. So with a peer observation, you might have someone come in and observe your classroom. They could have a checklist that looked at things like your learning environment, your instruction, what the teacher was doing, what the students were doing, what they were learning, what their engagement was like. And there's these protocols that are published. There's also ones you could develop on your own. There's also questions that might deal more with specific things like diversity or classroom management. So it'd be important. We also have evaluation tools that your supervisor will use. Things like CAST is what's used by Duval County School Districts, and it's what we'll be using for your evaluations through your internships here at the university that deal with very specific instruments. And these are things that not necessarily peers, but more like your supervisors would use in classroom observations, but it might be helpful to use similar instruments with your peers prior to your formal evaluations to help you be reflective about how you might improve your practice as a teacher. We could also do what's called a lesson study, and lesson study is really developed in Japan. It starts off with a study, and this is done in a group, and usually a research group. So you start off with a study phase where you really study the content of the lesson, and then you plan how you will implement that lesson or that content. Then one person from the team teaches while others observe, and then everyone as a group reflects upon that lesson. And then you can go back to that study and improvement. So it can be a cycle. And it's done by a group, and it's a really an intensive process, but as being part of a research group, I think that it results in really fabulous lessons. And there might be ways to modify this as a group, maybe in a professional learning community or as a grade level team. And then there's self-recorded lessons. So you might do a similar process to lesson study, but by yourself, where you might record your own lesson to reflect and process. That could be video or audible. You'd want to have a representative sample of lessons, perhaps, if you were trying to get an overall picture of your classroom. And we have some things called like swivel cameras. So you could get video, and the way it's really cool, you have this camera in your classroom and you wear something on your neck that A, picks up your voice, but also cues the camera in to follow you around the classroom. So you're constantly getting your video picked up. So it's not as stable, but it will follow you as you move and talk. And it's a really cool technique, a really cool way that technology can now capture our lessons really easily without having to have, another person there. So, and then a guided reflection protocol. So after you teach a lesson, it's really helpful to have, to not just, if I just say reflect on the lesson, that can be really difficult to know kind of what kinds of things you should be reflecting on. What should I be talking about in that lesson? And so guided reflection protocols can help you guide you through the types of reflective questions you should be asking yourself. So the first question is really what happened in the lesson? Then why did those things happen? What was the cause of them? What might that mean? And then what are the implications for my practice? How should I change based upon the things that I saw and the causes of it? So going through this protocol can help you really concentrate and focus in on effective reflective practice that will really change the way that you teach and impact the things that you do. And that can kind of help us with as part of a reflective journal where you're keeping a record of the things that you teach. And as a teacher, you have to be an expert both in your content area or areas that you teach, and then also in how students learn. And that's really what this class has been about, right? Is how students learn. And a reflective journal can help you record your ideas and techniques, the things you try in the classroom, and then how that worked or in ways of improving that practice. So really like as almost a scientific journal of what did I see and what did I do and how did I change those variables? And answering those reflection questions adding suggestions for future actions, all of this in a journal in one place, we can really keep a nice record of what you've done in the classroom. And finally, you might want to create a portfolio, and these portfolios can be a collection. If you ever wanted to become a nationally board certified teacher, you would submit a portfolio. As you go out for job interviews and looking for new opportunities in your career, you would put together a portfolio of the things that you've done. And some things that might include be included in a portfolio are things like your educational philosophy. Hopefully you've thought about that in your intro to education class, and as you move forward in your as you take more education classes, as you teach more, you're going to be refining that philosophy of education. Your resume, and as you get more experiences in schools, you'll be adding to that. Your goals as a teacher, perhaps example lesson plans connected to standards, activities, student work, evaluations from teachers, of your own teaching, things like your transcripts and letters of recommendation, all those things that add to the professionalism, the things that you've done, would be part of this observation schedule, of this portfolio. And then finally, how do we use technology for this reflective inquiry? And what's really been exciting about where we are today is that really digital portals have become a much bigger part of this reflective practice and professional learning. So I already mentioned how the National Board Certification is a collection of portfolios, and a lot of that's done online now. So we can have videos and pictures digitized to be part of that portfolio, which makes it a much more powerful piece. Also, NEA and AFT and other professional organizations like the National Council for Teachers of Mathematics have created online portals for professional learning that allow not only for professional development modules like we have in this class, but also opportunities for discussion boards and chats and ways that professionals can get help from other professionals through collaboration and discussion boards. There's also teacher wikis where you can work together to create documents, which is really powerful. And then there's things like Teachers Pay Teachers and other websites where you can get materials from other teachers that have already been developed and maybe vetted to use in your classrooms, because we know that teachers share, and that can be part of this reflective practice, that we can think about our own practice and collaboration with others. And I think that, again, that reflection can be a really powerful part of our own learning. So as we move forward, as we are thinking about our practice, we want to be thinking about the ways in which we can reflect and how that can become a better teacher and part of our self-regulation as teachers and part of that metacognitive process. So as you move forward through your careers, as you go forth and become amazing educators, these are all the types of things that I want you guys to be thinking about and metacognitive about in your own practice. So again, I hope you have a great week. If you have any questions, please reach out to me. I'm available through email, through a phone. I'm just a phone call away. Feel free to stop by my office and we can chat face to face. And lots of luck as you work through the end of the semester. Have a great day, guys. Bye.